I am a paleoclimatologist, which means that I'm kind of a weird cross between a geologist and a climate scientist. I have a doctorate in geology, but the focus of my research is on climate change. So I didn't choose this career, which is somewhat of a strange career to choose, just because I couldn't choose between geology and climate science. I actually started my career in sustainable development.
I spent a lot of time in these small villages in East Africa and Southern Africa, and after a while, I started talking to a lot of farmers and hearing a lot of stories about how they thought the rains were changing. And this got me really interested in rainfall in Africa and what we know about it. So I went back to New York and I started researching this, and it became very clear that the amount that we know about rainfall and climate change in the world's tropical regions is abysmal. We know very, very little. One of the things we've learned is that, has the climate changed in the past? Yes, absolutely. Climate has changed really dramatically in the past. The Earth has gone through hothouses, it has gone through ice ages, it has been wet, it has been dry, there's regional variations, there's all kinds of interesting climate changes that have occurred in the past. A couple of examples that I think will be really interesting to you all. One is a period of time that we refer to as the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum. It's a mouthful, the PETM for short. And I use this as an example partly because it happened about 55, 56 million years ago. And that's about when our beloved Rocky Mountains had just finished their uplift. I also choose it because it's one of the really well-known examples of what we call a hyperthermal in the Earth's history. And it's a really well-known example of a massive release of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere that happened very, very quickly. Another example, we'll come back to that in a second, is the transition, the most recent transition out of the last ice age. Now this, for a geologist, is very recent in time, right? The peak of the last ice age was about 21,000 years ago. So 55 million, 21,000, much more recent. And the last glacial maximum was a period of time when the Earth was globally a lot cooler, a lot drier, sea levels were a lot lower, and that's because a lot of that water was locked up in ice sheets that were especially in the northern hemisphere. So these are two examples, the PETM and the last ice age, the transition out of the last ice age. Two examples of CO2 being released into the atmosphere, temperature warming, very rapidly, very abruptly in some cases. So what's the difference? Why is anything different from that, from what we're seeing today? And this is a case where I am a geologist, I'm also at fault here. We kind of use some confusing wording when we discuss these climate changes. When we say rapid and abrupt, what do you think we mean? Does anyone have a guess? Hundreds of years, anybody else? Thousands? Couple million, okay, yeah. So the release of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere during the PETM, there's a lot of debates about it, but it was around 10,000, 20,000 years. That is really rapid, right, for a geologist? It's fast, it's really fast. But to you and I, where we have an average life expectancy of, I don't know, less than a century, not very fast, pretty slow. When we talk about the transition out of the last ice age, same thing. Last ice age, the peak was 21,000 years ago. And most of that CO2 was released into the atmosphere over about 15,000 years. 15,000 years, 10,000 years, 20,000 years, these are rapid to geologists. It's not so rapid to everybody else, right? So to kind of demonstrate that, I have what I'm referring here to as a time stick. So everything you see here in blue is covering 20,000 years. And that tiny, tiny bit of yellow at the very end is 150 years, okay? 20,000 years for CO2 to be released in the atmosphere. 150 is what we've done now. So that's the difference in the rate. So what have we learned? We know that CO2 is important. We know that it's very tightly coupled with changes in temperature. We know that CO2 can be released by all kinds of mechanisms. We also know that today's CO2 is being released by us, because we can chemically fingerprint that CO2, and I can explain that later if you're interested. And so we know it's coming from us. So what does that say for what we do. What don't we know? What are the uncertainties? So to me, I'm a fairly early career scientist, and to me, I don't really think that this question of temperature or CO2 is particularly interesting anymore. We know. We've figured this stuff out pretty well. There are some error bars that we'd like to smack down, and the climate modelers are working on the refining projections, sure. But I started out today by telling you why I got involved in this field in the first place, right? It's because of water. Because people who rely on rainfall are really worried, as they should be. Not just people. Animals, plants, conservation organizations are really concerned about water. Temperature is important, but the way that it influences rainfall is really the next step.